Hi, this is V-Ray Shufford and I'm back. I have an exciting book that I am so excited about entitled Choosing the Passionate Life Now. And a little bit about this book is that I've taken some people and some testimonials in their lives that have helped them choose to live a more passionate life. And in my own life, I've seen so many things and have gone through so many situations that has made me look at life for really what it is. Being a firefighter, I've seen so many people's lives just in an instant change just like that. And so in this concept of choosing the passionate life now, I want to share with you that life is like a vapor and then it's gone. So sit back and enjoy choosing the passionate life now.
I'm Cliff Ackerman, and I choose to live the passionate life. My story starts, I'm actually a cancer survivor. This was back in 1998. I was 35, and I was diagnosed with stage 4 non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. I did not respond to treatment, and I had multiple surgeries, chemos, and different procedures done. This was the last resort for me. I mean, you can imagine if you know somebody that has cancer, sometimes this is a death sentence. So they looked to the National Registry back in 99, and they found a potential match, somebody that joined the registry and was willing to step up. I was given a second chance in life. I was given the opportunity, a donor gave me those cells that saved my life. And I grafted well, had a successful transplant. And now, it's 15 years later, and I'm actually a representative or a community engagement rep for Be the Match Registry. I'm very passionate about this because this gave me a second chance in life. That's why I'm passionate. That's why I praise God. I want to make sure that I am living a full and passionate life, but find this within yourself. How and where this passion can make you live and help others. I'm Cliff Ackerman, and I choose to live the passionate life.
Hi, I'm Eric Beal, and this is my story about a passionate life. So my incident, man, it occurred August of 2002. We were called out to a fire, me and my officer and my other firemen, co-workers and whatnot. We were called out to a structure fire. We made an approach on the structure fire, and being the youngest one on the engine, I had the nozzle. So as we approached the structure fire, we made access through the front door. Me and my officer went in the structure fire at that time, and I recall going in, I felt a tremendous amount of heat once we first got into the structure, and I felt it on my ears and kind of told me to get low, kind of go back to instinct of training, being a new rookie and all. So got low, continued to follow my officer. And I remember getting to an area in the house where it just, a tremendous amount of heat just kind of came out of nowhere and a huge orange glow. So at that point, my line was down, and I just remember getting a sense of calmness over myself and stopping and pausing for a moment, if you would, and thinking about what was at hand. And the first thing that came to me was my wife and my firstborn, my daughter, who she was 8 months pregnant at the time. So. And once that kind of came over me, and I paused and asked God, not like this. And at that point, I began to kind of calm down, and kind of, I guess, instincts of training kind of kicked in or whatnot, and proceeded through the house fire and exited through the back and proceeded to a boarded up door and tried to knock it down, but it wouldn't budge. I guess when I prayed and asked God, not like this, he took that calmness and put it over me. I didn't really feel any pain at the moment, or maybe it was just, I don't know, adrenaline. But from the moment me getting out, exiting the structure on the porch, and they put me in the back of the box in the ambulance, One of the first things that came to my mind was I lost my wedding ring. And I figured my wife was gonna be pissed because I lost my wedding ring. That's a weird thing to think of at that time frame, but I just didn't want any static at the house, you know what I'm saying? So I was thinking of that, actually. But then once we got everything situated in the back of the box, I mean, the back of the ambulance, they took me to the hospital. And when the doctors came in, they noticed everything, and all of the personnel came in, my staff, my supervisors and whatnot, if you would, they came in and took a look at things. It was a lot of commotion, and I was just trying to make sure that someone would contact my wife and keep her calm, because like I explained, she was 8 months pregnant. So my worries were more or less on her and how she would feel. I really wasn't in the midst of thinking about myself. I didn't think my injuries were that severe. I just didn't know at the time. So after we got to the hospital, it was a lot of commotions. The doctors wasn't talking too much, but I knew it did eventually come out that it was one of the worst injuries that they had saw, and they actually had thoughts of actually amputating my hands at the time. I had a lot of time to think as far as going through this whole journey and this whole process, as I wrote you, but it's taking something negative and finding a positive within it. And the best way I can explain it is, man, one of the tattoos that I have says scarred but not scorned. So when I go and I shake an individual's hand, like I'm shaking your hand, for example, what I witness a lot inside in society with citizens and stuff, the first thing a person's gonna do, they're gonna look down at my hands.
Yes, sir.
And I catch them in eye contact looking at my hands. So the first thing that they look at is my scars. But what they don't understand after they meet me and talk to me, even if they have enough nerve to just go ahead and ask me what happened, I'm open to talk to them about it, because I use it as my opportunity for me to explain my testimony of what I went through, so it may help you get over something that you're going through. So just because you're scarred on the outside doesn't mean it has to score on you. You see what I'm saying? So I mean, you take this is obviously a negative thing that's happened to me, but it's not a negative thing that's gonna hold me back. You see what I'm saying? So I took something that was negative and build the positive out of it by being able to talk to the person that's at the gym that's having some weight problems, or talk to the person that just lost one of his limbs because he went and served for his country in Iraq or whatever, or talk to the little kid that's doing bad in school because his dad or his mom is beating on him or whatever, you know. So anybody that's faced with a misfortunate circumstance, you can find a positive out of it. You just kind of got to find that to get over it, because if you don't, then you're looking at a pit of self-pity that can pull you down. And once it consumes you, it eats you up. And then it just infects, it's infectious, man. It infects everybody around us. So me going through that, I actually believe I had it instilled with me from my parents, man. Just not to, I don't deal with negativity. You know, I don't like it. I think it's infectious. It's, to me, it's just like an AIDS epidemic. You know what I mean? It can take over you and consume your whole world. So having that going into this situation allowed me and my peace and everything, the blessings that I was given from God himself, allowed me to use it as a challenge and keep pushing forward, you know what I mean? So most people want to take that easy road. Sometimes you need to embrace that hard one, because it's that hard one that's going to make you tougher. So you see what I'm saying? So that's just my outlook on it. I'm Eric Beale, and I choose to live a passionate life.
Well, that night, truck 20 was responding to a major accident with people pinned, with engine 22 and back then 722. And as we got there and saw what we had, you know, we had two young ladies that were in a car that ran off the road. And with that, we saw that it was going to take some time. And now, you know, she was alone. It was late at night, and it was one of those instances to where everything that we tried caused further injury to her. And so we were trying to take our time, be methodical about it, so that we didn't do those things and create further injury to her. And during that process, you know, it was becoming very evident that she very well might not survive this. And so through the whole process, my role was basically at that point became the person to just to hold her hand and talk to her and explain to her the things that were going on. She knew then that we had a connection, and that all of these people with all of these noises and everything else that was going on around her, that she wasn't alone out there.
You know, she was because she didn't know anybody personally, but that all these people that were there working around her, trying different things and doing this, were all in her best interest and all for her welfare, and that she was there with people that cared about her. And then as this process went on, she ended up passing away as we got her out of the vehicle. I think as we sit here and what makes me think about after that run that we made, and you look at it, it really drove home the, I guess, the feeling of what we do, and that we're not here, and we don't always save everybody. Things are going to happen. People are going to pass away, and we're going to see that, you know, as we do that. But we understand that, you know, we have a passion for what we do. We care about what we do. We care about people. And what really got to me is, you know, is we are a people-oriented business. It's not a lot of, you know, fires and things like that. Sure, we do all that. But our greatest feat is when we are working with people and we touch their lives, whether it's for the, you know, if it's a great outcome or unfortunately they're the other outcome, but we're there to help that transition, make it easier for them. We're helping the other family members as it comes through there, you know, is helping them with ease their pain as things happen. And sometimes, you know, our guys with that passion goes over and it's an officer standing by that other family member, just explaining to them, holding their hand, putting their arm around them, you know, talking to them about what we're doing and what's going on. So to me, it drove through, you know, that we're not this callous, great big group of guys that come in there, you know, all big macho and stuff. We're caring human individuals that come in there and try to ease these people's pain and try to do the best we can with it. I'm Stuart Grant from the Grapevine Fire Department, Operations Chief, and I choose to live a passionate life.
What you just witnessed was three individual stories from all walks of life, but the common denominator in their stories is that all of them have now chosen to live a more passionate life because of their stories. There's so much more stories in the book, but I implore you as a reader to get the book. Read it for yourself, share it with someone, because at some point in time, someone is going to be needing this type of book. They're going to be dealing with some type of situation, whether it be cancer, whether it be some type of kid, some type of situation in their job, but someone's gonna need some type of encouragement, some type of enlightenment to get them through to the next step. So go get the book. Where can you get the book? At vrayshufford.com. Thank you.